Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Good Flies, Favorite Trout Patterns and How They Got That Way, by John Gierach, narrated by David Colacci. Introduction to the New Edition. Good Flies seems more regional and eccentric than it did when I published it 14 years ago. I now see it as another in a long line of books by fishermen extolling their favorite fly patterns, seasoned with random thoughts about fish, fishing, and whatever else comes to mind. These books are as different as the people who wrote them, but they all follow the same rough outline, and all seem to have been written partly to get something off the author's chest, and partly in a genuine attempt to be helpful. After all, when you've spent years thinking about fly patterns, tinkering at the vise, and occasionally catching a trout, you begin to think your ideas could be useful to others. These books come in all shapes and sizes. Some, like Selective Trout by Doug Swisher and Carl Richards, 1971, and before that, Matching the Hatch by Ernest Schwiebert, 1955, were big landmark books that codified a way of thinking about fly patterns and became part of the fly fishing culture. Fishermen still talk about trout being selective or having to match the hatch, even though they've never read the books. Others, like Iwamasa Flies by Ken Iwamasa and AK's Fly Box by AK Best, as well as dozens of other books, are quirkier, more local, and more idiosyncratic, basically peeks inside the fly boxes of good, thoughtful fishermen, for what it's worth. And sometimes it's worth a lot. Most of the flies in Ken Iwamasa's book were recognizable, but he also introduced some patterns that were unlike anything we'd seen before, like the Tarcher nymph, and especially the Iwamasa duns. I think those duns came out of some of the first original thinking in fly tying in a generation. They were stunningly realistic in a spare, impressionistic sort of way, and once you got the hang of it, they were easy enough to tie with inexpensive and easy-to-find materials. You could say the patterns owed debts to the no-hackle duns for their uncluttered silhouettes, and to the comparaduns for the placement of deer hair tips as legs. But that's just an acknowledgement that fly patterns don't arise in a vacuum, and it would be just as accurate to say they were completely original. The Iwamasa duns were specialized patterns for picky trout in slow currents, and I'm surprised they didn't catch on better than they did, although some fishermen who like technical spring creeks and tailwaters still tie and carry them as secret weapons. AK Best is a different kind of tire, a traditionalist whose innovations are so subtle you may not even notice them right away. At first glance, his flies just look like they'd work, but then it begins to sink in that, although they're very much like the traditional patterns you've been seeing for years, they're trimmer and perkier than most, with just noticeably thinner bodies, taller wings, and longer tails cocked at a slight upward angle. And there are the colors that more closely match those of natural insects than any flies I've seen. AK dyes most of the materials himself, using his own painstakingly worked-out recipes. He dyes dry fly necks, wingers, quills, and biots, and his dubbing is blended from a combination of colors using precise, reproducible formulas for accuracy and consistency. That is, he gets his blue-winged olive dubbing by blending 3 parts white, a half part yellow, 1 part ginger, 1 part olive, and a half part gray rabbit fur, because he says, there are no solid colors in nature. So many tires asked him how he did it that he finally published a book on the subject, Dyeing and Bleaching Natural Fly Tying Materials. AK is also the fastest tire I've ever seen. At the height of his production, with a mortgage and daughters in college, he turned out 3,000 dozen flies a year while working full-time in a fly shop and still finding time to go fishing. That gave him a perspective on the relationship between craftsmanship and practicality that most of us lack. I've been tying flies for my own use for a little over 40 years now. with a couple of mostly ill-fated detours into professional tying early on, when I was short of cash, and I've spent most of that time trying to mimic the styles of other tires and appropriate their patterns for my own use. That's most of the time, but not all. After reading Vince Marinaro's A Modern Dry Fly Code, another quirky regional book that introduced the thorax dun, I thought I should invent something myself, but I never did. Everything I came up with had either been done before, and better, or it turned out to be unworkable. It's not that there were no new ideas left. It's just that others always had them before I did. I also had the usual flirtation with burned wings, extended bodies, and so on, or what Dave Whitlock once called eyeballs, elbows, and arseholes. I managed to make some nice-looking flies, but they were time-consuming to tie and didn't work any better than flies that were quicker and easier to make. I finally came to agree with most of the fishermen I know that flies weren't individual works of art, but expendable ammunition. Of course, I did learn things from tinkering, reading, and talking to other tyers and fishermen that came in handy on the flies I ended up tying to fish, but many of those things don't really show on the flies themselves. For instance, I always loved parachute dry flies, but I hated tying them, especially the little tiny ones, until Ed Engel showed me an easier, neater way to tie off the hackles. I won't try to describe it here, but there are directions for how to do it on page 387 of The Fly Tyer's Benchside Reference to Techniques and Dressing Styles by Ted Leeson and Jim Schollmeyer, which is the most useful fly tying book I've ever owned. The most I ever managed in terms of originality was to make minor changes to existing patterns, like tying a wing differently, either because it was easier or it made the fly prettier, or changing the hook and adding dumbbell eyes to a muddler minnow because I thought it actually improved the pattern. But, not counting a few exceptions back when I was young and foolish, I resisted putting my name on them and actually became a stickler for attribution. That was a subtext in Good Flies. If I couldn't find out who invented a pattern, I'd at least tell you where I first learned about it. I've started tying steelhead flies since I published Good Flies, but as tempting as it was to include a little section on them, I decided against it. I only go steelheading once or twice a year, and don't know enough about the patterns to talk about them intelligently. My strategy for picking a steelhead fly is to show my box to a local fisherman and ask if anything looks good. If he points at one of mine, that's fine. If he hands me one of his, that's even better. I do have some sentimental favorites, though. I like the Ackroyd, an old British salmon fly, and Deck Hogan's more recent variation of it called the Skagit Mist, as well as a feather-wing spay version of the old green butt skunk. These are complicated, drop-dead gorgeous flies that are difficult to tie without actually being impossible, and they've worked fine for me, if only because I like them so much that I keep them in the water. I also like some of the simpler hair wings, like the Undertaker, one of the great fly names, the Black Bear Green Butt, the Black Dress, and the Black Gordon. I like the colors and the graceful, elegant shapes, and I like working with materials like paired goose shoulder, golden pheasant tippet and crest, brightly colored floss, black bear hair, and, of course, jungle cock. I put jungle cock nails on everything because it's such a weirdly beautiful natural material, and because it dresses up a classic fly the way nothing else can. And I suppose because I can remember when it was illegal to own jungle cock in the United States. That didn't mean you couldn't get it if you wanted it badly enough, just that it was hard to find and prohibitively expensive. They used to smuggle jungle cock necks into the country by sticking them to the backs of a few Indian gamecock necks in a large shipment, so that even if customs officials decided to paw through them, the contraband could still go unnoticed. Don't ask me how I know that. Jungle cock necks are still obscenely expensive, but at least now you can buy one in broad daylight using your own name. Steelheading has allowed my suppressed tendency to tie pointlessly elaborate flies to surface occasionally, but its real value is the idea, common in the sport, that cast, drift, depth, daily and seasonal timing, fly size, and persistence all matter more than what fly you tie on. The only reason you settle on a handful of favorite patterns is so you don't have to think about it anymore. I've also tied flies for Atlantic salmon, Chinooks, and other Pacific salmon, and have fooled around with intruders and tube flies with some success. That is, I've caught some fish on them, but again, I don't know enough about any of that stuff to have much to say about it. Why, for instance, will Chinooks in one river eat hot pink flies the size of lemmings, and in another river prefer trim little comets tied on size 12 hooks? I have no idea. I even fooled around with tenkara for the best part of one season. That's the centuries-old Japanese method of fishing with a long rod, in the neighborhood of 13 feet, with a length of line and leader attached to the tip. No guides, no reel, no extra line. It's basically the fly fishing version of a cane, pole, and string, but much more elegant. It's interesting and sometimes effective for things like high-sticking a dry fly through complicated pocket water, but in the end I decided it wasn't versatile enough. Another sticking point for me is that a pure tenkara fisherman uses a single fly for all his fishing. I don't mean one fly on the leader at a time. I mean one fly ever, period, usually a medium-sized, drab, soft hackle, with the hackle flared forward over the eye of the hook so it pulses in the water. It works, better than you'd think, actually, and the reliance on technique reminds me a little of steelhead fishing. But I enjoy fly tying too much to ever limit myself to a single pattern. If nothing else, what would I do with all my boxes of flies? So whatever expertise I have is still with conventional trout flies. I wrote this book partly because I just wanted to write a book about flies. It seemed like everyone I knew was doing it, but also because I thought I'd finally settled on a workable selection of go-to patterns for trout fishing in and around the Rocky Mountain West. They weren't the only flies I fished, but they were the ones I depended on day in and day out for years. And for the most part, they still are. I tie my crawdad pattern differently now. Went to synthetics and a different hook for the adult damselfly to make it easier to tie, more durable, and give it a more realistic silhouette. And I now use a different style of wing on some of my hare's ear parachutes. But aside from those few changes, I still use the same flies. You could say I'm set in my ways, which would explain why my fly boxes look like they're from the 1960s, or you could say I apply an impossible standard. That is, before I'd replace an old favorite pattern with a new one, the new fly would have to catch more fish, or at least catch as many fish, and also be quicker, easier, and/or cheaper to tie. That confluence of events doesn't come along very often. A few years ago, on the Henry's Fork in Idaho, a young guide looked at my dry fly box and said, "Dude, that's really old school." Okay, fair enough, but then that afternoon we matched each other fish for fish, I with my fur and feather version of a pale morning dun, and he with whatever the hot new foam and plastic pattern was that season. I'm not normally a competitive fisherman, but after that old school crack, I enjoyed holding my own with this whippersnapper. In fact, I'm beginning to think the hidden message behind the hundreds, if not thousands, of fly patterns fishermen use successfully is that it's almost impossible not to catch fish if you're a decent caster, hit the hatches right, and put in your time. John Gierach, Larimer County, Colorado, 2014. Introduction to the First Edition. Tying our own flies is where many of us go off the deep end with fly fishing. That's how it happened with me, and I was even aware of it at the time. I mean, I was young and crazed, and I was sort of looking for the deep end. But things didn't work out the way I expected them to, a trick that life has often played on me. I figured I'd learn the craft, master the standard flies everyone used, then move out into new territory and eventually come up with a selection of stunningly innovative, yet still traditional-looking patterns that would be mine alone and that would catch fish anytime, anywhere. After reading a few accounts by famous tyers, it became obvious that's how it was done. The only question was whether I'd keep these new patterns secret and just catch the hell out of fish, or take them public in an oversized book full of color photos and become rich and famous. What actually happened was I became a hopeless tinkerer. I tied and fished every pattern I could find, simply because it was there to try, and went through that inevitable phase in which the more complicated and difficult a fly was to tie, the more I liked it. I looked at artificial flies and caught real insects, talked to fishermen and other tyers, read anything anyone cared to publish on the subject, and to this day I completely agree with every known theory of fly design. Now, 30 years later, I have a pretty impressive collection of hooks and feathers, I've become an adequate tyer almost by accident, and I've decided that many of the fine points of fly tying are lost on the fish. From this vantage point, it seems to have taken me 3 decades to arrive at the obvious. But it wasn't that simple. In that time, half of the best fishermen I met had museum-quality tackle and hundreds of flies so perfect they were almost too pretty to fish. But the other half fastened their reels to their rods with electrician's tape and fished a handful of really crappy flies. When I looked into the fly boxes of tyers who were also good fishermen, something I still like to do, I saw flies that were either long and gangly, or short and stubby, neat or sloppy, trim or fat, bright or dull. They all caught fish in the right hands, and some of the best of them really did look like drowned rats. I took up fly tying because it seemed artistic, self-reliant, frugal, and even scientific in a quaint, naturalistic sense. I decided to try and get good at it on general principles, because that's what you're supposed to do, and as my flies got a little prettier, I did catch a few more fish. But I was learning to fly fish at the same time I was learning to tie flies, and a stealthy, accurate cast and a good drift can make more difference than a handsome fly. Still, flies seemed crucial because it was a fly that finally connected me to a fish. However, occasionally, however briefly. I do remember catching fish on some of the very first flies I tied, as clunky and flimsy as they were. They were little browns and brookies from freestone creeks and bluegills from some quarry ponds, but they were fish, and I ate a lot of them in those days. I also remember that my first favorite dry fly was the mosquito, because you could tie the whole pattern from a single grizzly cape, and I liked the economy of that. The pattern called for a grizzly spade-hackle tail, stripped grizz quill body, grizz hackle-tip wings, and a grizz collar hackle. It was also a buggy-looking fly that caught trout as often as not, and if you showed it to someone who didn't fly fish, he'd say, "Damn, that looks just like a real mosquito," even though it actually didn't look anything like a mosquito. I liked the hare's ear nymph for the same reason. Except for a wire rib, the version of it I started with was made entirely of fur from a hare's mask. There was a moment there when things seemed simple, and my entire selection of tying materials consisted of a grizzly rooster neck, a European hare's mask, some copper wire stripped from a lamp cord, and a spool of black thread. But it didn't last. I decided I should have a lot of flies, again because that's what you're supposed to want. Some really good fishermen had lots of flies. There was a small but growing industry promoting lots of flies, and stories from fishing writers and real people alike revolved around flies. The implication in most fishing stories was that in any given situation there was the one right fly, and in 9 stories out of 10 it was a fly I didn't have. If you had that fly, you'd catch fish. If not, you were screwed, and a desperate and lasting sadness descends on you when you realize you're a fisherman who's not going to catch a fish today. Lots of different flies began to look like insurance policies against getting skunked. But then there were still those guys with white hair sticking out from beneath dented cowboy hats who could fish a size 12 Rio Grande King through a hatch of number 22 blue-winged olives and catch trout. They reminded me of mountain lions. I didn't see them often, but when I did, they made a big impression. I also ran into the idea of flies as art, which further complicated things. I don't mean really well-tied fishing flies. I mean display flies tied by people who had no intention of ever showing them to a fish. This stuff would have just been beautiful and harmless, except that the line between flies to look at and flies for fishing was never clearly drawn. So those of us who had it bad ended up laboriously tying dry flies with extended bodies, burned wings, eyeballs, and at their worst, little knotted legs with knees and ankles. We probably intended to fish them, but when it came right down to it, we usually didn't. We had too much time invested in them to risk losing them. And they didn't float right anyway. I've even fooled around with fully dressed Atlantic salmon flies for a while, and went salmon fishing a few times to justify that. I never got anywhere near good at tying salmon flies, but I finally managed to make 2 that are passable if you don't examine them too closely. I have them framed over my tying desk, along with 4 good ones by Malin Osman and 2 by David Sokasitz. They've almost become wallpaper by now, but I do stop and look at them now and then. I consider them an example and a warning. They exhibit the kind of craftsmanship I aspire to, as well as the needless extremes to which I probably shouldn't go. I don't think all of my experimental tying was a waste of time, though. It was a way of scouting out the countryside that gave me some confidence, taught me a lot about fly design and material handling, and finally showed me what kind of flies I wanted to tie by exhausting almost all the kinds I didn't want to tie. Even the salmon flies taught me a few tricks that have come in handy on feather-winged streamer patterns. I also learned that it's possible to see a fly pattern in your mind that will never quite fit on an actual hook. Writers are familiar with this phenomenon, too. E.B. White once said that a book is never as good as it is just before you start writing it. All that tying also gave me a useful take on perfection. Everyone wants to be able to tie flawless flies with every hair in place, but at the same time, anything the fish don't appreciate is sort of theoretical. In the course of writing this book, I had to tie near-perfect examples of all the flies as models for the illustrator, and that showed me how far I regularly stray from perfection and still catch fish. I learned most of what I now know and use about fly tying from my old friend A.K. Best. It was nothing formal. We worked together at a fly shop for a while, and on slow afternoons, especially later on, when the shelves were half empty and the place was quietly going bankrupt, we'd sit and tie. Mostly I just watched him, but he was a good teacher, so if I asked him something, he'd explain it first one way and then another, until he saw the light go on. A.K. was the first professional tyer I ever knew, and I was, and still am, damned impressed by the downright prettiness of his flies, their uniformity, and his apparently effortless tying speed. I was even more impressed later when I did a short stint as a professional tyer myself. A.K. taught me a lot of the nuts and bolts of it, economy of motion, how to get proper proportions by using the hook shank as a ruler, how to tie durable flies by working at the strength limit of the materials, how to tie faster, not by tying faster, but by systematically sizing, pairing, and otherwise laying out the materials beforehand, and so on. He also tried to teach me that a clean desk is a happy desk, but that one never quite stuck. By now, with his books, columns, videotapes, and workshops, AK has become a guru to a lot of tires. I was just lucky enough to get in on that early and beat the rush. AK is also a practical man. He believes that flies exist to catch fish, and that they should be quick and easy to make, and as thoughtlessly expendable as shotgun shells are to a pheasant hunter. Sooner or later, the best flies you'll ever tie will be snapped off in fish or bushes, or occasionally chewed to pieces by hungry trout. They can be pretty, and they can and should be well tied, but extra steps and needless flying buttresses should be avoided. Something else that should probably be avoided is pointless innovation. Changing perfectly good existing patterns for no apparent reason, except perhaps so you can pose as a genius. I've done this myself a time or two, so I know it's not that hard to fool yourself and others, if only because it's nearly impossible to tie a fly that won't catch a fish sooner or later. If you diddle with fly patterns for your own amusement, and that makes you happy, fine. When it comes right down to it, there's no wrong way to tie flies. But if it goes commercial, it can get a little insidious. I've come to believe that the sport is cluttered with flies that were tied for no other reason than to sell them to people who already have enough flies. That, and the peculiarly American belief that new, weird, and different is always better than old and reliable. Most of the so-called new patterns that you see now weren't so much invented as they were assembled from spare parts. The front end of one fly is grafted to the back end of another, or the wing material, body color, or hackling style is changed on an old pattern and it's called new. Sometimes this is done under pressure to get something eye-catching in the next catalog or magazine, or to create a demand for some new tying material. And although I don't think it happens often, I know that at least in some cases, patterns that have never actually been fished have been marketed as proven fish-getters. I also think some of us tiers are too quick to claim authorship of patterns. At this late date, there's very little that's truly new in fly tying, and most patterns fall into broad types that have been around forever in one way or another. That's why you can copyright the name of a fly, but it's nearly impossible to patent a pattern. Most flies are like folk songs. They're out there in public where anyone can interpret them, but you can't truly own one any more than you can own a cat. And although Ramblin' Jack Elliott's version of East Virginia Blues is all but unrecognizable at times, in the end it's the same old song. But then the difference between needless and real innovation is sometimes a hard call. Everybody thinks they can do it better, and some of them can. And sometimes the most insignificant things can make all the difference to a trout. Back in the 1930s, when Lee Wolfe decided to tie a royal coachman with hair, wings, and tail and rename it the Royal Wolf, it might have seemed like a small thing, but it made the fly more durable, more buoyant, and visible, and has probably kept the old pattern alive well past what would have been its prime. I know tiers who are endlessly fiddling with patterns, old and new, for all kinds of good reasons. Some, including lots of guides, want to make them quicker, cheaper, more visible, and more durable, because, as any guide will tell you, most clients can't see, and they're hell on flies. Some tiers are in love with the lusciousness of the materials and the blank canvas of a bare hook. They're having fun, they're not hurting anyone, and they're probably catching fish, so they should be left alone. Others are trying to imitate specific insects in order to catch particularly cagey trout, or trying to come up with something just a little bit different for fish that have already seen everything that's for sale at the local fly shop. Still others are trying to clarify their thinking about why a trout eats a fly in the first place, a question over which lives have been wasted. In the end, the beauty of fly tying is that there are all kinds of ways of making it work, as well as all kinds of ways of caring whether it works or not. Still, now and then someone does come up with something the fish can't leave alone. It might be a little bit different than the flies you're used to, but it still has that recognizable look. As Tom McGuane said of the Adams dry fly, it says bug to the trout in a general yet friendly and duplicitous way. When I see a fly that does that, I politely ask to borrow it, and I study it for a minute, so that maybe I'll be able to reproduce it back home after I've lost it to a pine tree, all the time hoping I haven't given this particular tire the pointless innovation lecture recently. I guess I decided to write this book now because my fly tying has finally settled down to match the way I fish. Don't get me wrong, my fly boxes are still a mess. I still gratefully accept strange flies that work from friends and kindly strangers. I still have a weak spot for odd local fly patterns, and I still carry more flies than I need. But I've also arrived at a core handful of patterns that I tie the same way year after year, that I usually either start with or come back to, and that, in fact, catch most of my fish. I think of these flies as regional to a stretch of the Rocky Mountain West, roughly from Colorado to Alberta and British Columbia, because that's where I do most of my fishing. But a few of them have also worked well in exotic and faraway places like Labrador and Pennsylvania. They reflect an inordinate fondness for mayflies and a lot of freestone stream and lake fishing, but some are pretty much meant for tailwaters and spring creeks, where things can get a little tricky. I think most of these flies are pretty, you know.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.